Hello everyone, welcome to Easy Explanation. So in this video tutorial I'll be covering previous year questions discussion. So this is part 1, and many more tutorials on this topic will be coming in future. So in this video tutorial I'll be discussing around 6 questions. So the first question is, which has been asked in 2074 Ashwin. So the question is, what are computer program and computer programming? And the second part is, explain the steps that are required to build a program for solving a certain problem. So this question might have been asked for 8 marks, 2 marks for this definition and 6 marks for the second part. Okay, so you have to answer the question accordingly. Like for 2 marks question, you no need to write like 2 paragraph or 3 paragraph. So you can write the definition, that's all. And for 6 marks of question, you have to explain the parts. So answer the questions accordingly. So first part is, what are computer programs? Okay, so a computer program is collection of instructions. Of course, whatever we do the programming, that is a collection of instructions that can be executed by computer to perform a specific task. Okay, so for example, if you want to add 2 numbers, so you give a collection of instructions, you write a program and the computer performs that task and you get the result. A computer program is usually written by a computer programmer in a programming language. Okay, so if you are writing a program to find the sum of 2 numbers in C language, so C is a programming language and you are the programmer. Next, what is computer programming? So computer programming is the process of developing and implementing various sets of instructions to enable a computer to do certain tasks. Okay, so when you are developing this program, okay, we are implementing it, so that is called programming. Fine. So this is first part and this is for 2 marks, I guess. Now second part is, explain the steps that are required to build a program for solving a certain problem. Okay, so it is problem. So our second part is problem solving using computer. Okay, so programming is a problem solving activity, of course. Okay, so when we write a program, what we do? We are actually writing an instructions for the computer to solve something for us. Okay, so whatever we are programming, whatever we are giving instructions, that is nothing but we are giving instructions to computer to solve our problem. Okay, so using a computer as a problem solving tool, following steps are involved. Okay, so for making our computer solve a problem for us, we give the following instructions or we follow the following steps. Okay, so there are 7 steps: problem analysis, algorithm development, flowchart development, coding, compilation and execution, debugging and testing, and documentation. So first part is problem analysis. So what is problem analysis? It means to analyze the problem. It means to know the problem. You should know the nature of problem before solving it. So it applies whenever you go for exam. So first of all, you read your question properly and then only you start solving the problem. So if you have studied a problem statement, then you must analyze the problem and determine how to solve it. First, you should know the type of problem, that is the nature of the problem. To analyze means you should try to know the steps that lead you to have an exact solution. Okay, so before solving any problem, you should know the nature of problem. Next step is algorithm. So what is algorithm? An algorithm is the step-by-step description of a procedure written in human understandable language for solving a given problem. Okay, so to solve a given problem, we write a set of steps. Okay, so that is called algorithm. So a good algorithm should be correct, it should be effective, it should be defined properly and should have finite number of steps. Next is flowchart. So flowchart is pictorial description, okay, in picture form, in the forms of symbols, shapes, same step, like a pictorial representation of algorithm. The steps we wrote in algorithm, now we'll convert it into a pictorial description. So flowchart contains a set of symbols, shapes. Okay, so it makes use of symbols which are connected among them to indicate the flow of information and processing. Okay, so the process of drawing a flowchart for an algorithm is known as flowcharting. Next part is coding. So what is coding? The set of instructions that we write, okay, in any language, that is called coding. In order to make a program in any programming language, what we have written is known as code. The act of writing code in a computer language is known as coding. In other words, code is set of instructions that a computer can understand. Okay, so whatever you write to code in C language, like to add two number, to subtract two number, so that is called coding. Next is compilation and execution. Okay, so the process by which source codes of a computer language are translated into machine code. Okay, so what is compilation? Because we human being, we write code in human readable format. So that format is not understandable by machines. So machine understands only in the form of binary bit, that is zeros and one. So we need to convert that our language, our high level language, into machine level language or machine understandable language. That is called compilation. After compilation, if everything is okay. So after compilation, if your code is okay, if you have written everything properly, code is going under the other process that is known as execution. We can get the required output after execution process. Next is debugging and testing. So what is debugging? It is the process of detecting and removing the error in a program so that the program produces the desired result. Okay, so you might have an experience. Okay, so whenever you write a code, you get a number of errors. So the process of removing that error, okay, correcting that error, that is called debugging. So debugging is the discovery and correction of programming error, and testing ensures that program performs correctly the required task. Okay, so whatever tasks you have written the program to perform, whatever tasks, so testing ensures that that task has been performed. And the last is program documentation. So program documentation refers to details, writing details about your program. So whatever you have done, you have to maintain in a document form. Okay, so while writing program, it is good programming practice to make a brief explanatory note on the programmer's program segment. This explanatory note is called comment. So for program documentation, you can comment your program. You can write, like, if you're writing a program to add two numbers, so before above the program, you can comment and write, this is a program for summing two number. Okay, so thus it helps other programmer to understand the program. Okay, so if you give that program to some other programmer, so they'll read that comment section and they'll know, okay, this is a program to add two numbers. Fine, so this is problem analysis using computer system. Coming to second question, okay, so does algorithm and flowchart design makes programming faster and easier? So this is the first part, and the second part is draw flowchart to check whether number is Armstrong or not. Okay, so again, this question can be of 8 marks. So first part can be of 2 marks again, and second part can be of 6 marks, or first part can be of 3 and second 5. So total of 8 marks. So this question has been asked in 2068 Chaitra. So for this type of questions, like point wise question, you can write up to 5 points. Okay, so yes, of course, algorithm and flowchart design makes programming faster and easier. So to justify your point, you can give some points here. Okay, so I have given here 5 points. You can give some other points if you know. So they provide good documentation. Finding error and debugging is easier if you write algorithm and flowchart. They are easy to understand. Of course, anything in the form of English language or in pictorial form, it's easy to understand. It helps the programmer to write the code. Okay, so you might have an experience before writing code. If you write algorithm and if you draw the flowchart, so it becomes easy for you to write the code. It is easy and efficient to analyze the problem. Okay, so these are some points. You can add yours point if you want. So next part is draw flowchart to check whether a number is Armstrong or not. Okay, so in this question, they have given us, what is the question? So the question is, hint, Armstrong number is a number that is equal to the sum of cubes. Okay, so they have told sum of cubes, so we have to find 3-digit number. Okay, so the question is draw a flowchart to check whether a number is Armstrong or not. So for this question, Armstrong number is, like, if we take a 3-digit number, so if we cube the individual digit and sum it, so that sum should be equal to the number. Fine, so that is Armstrong number. So for flowchart, we can start it. Okay, we can declare variables like number for the number that we are taking, remainder to store the remainder, temporary variable, that is temp, in order to store the number, and we can also set. Okay, so here something is missing. It is set sum equals to 0. Okay, sorry for this. So here you can write set sum equals to 0. Okay, after that we have read num. Okay, so we'll read num from by scanf function. After that, we'll store our num in a temp variable. Fine. So the cursor goes like this. So we'll find remainder equals to num mod 10. Okay. So remainder equals to num mod 10. Sum equals to sum plus remainder into remainder into remainder, and num equals to num divided by 10. Okay. So we do this. We follow this step. Okay. Till our num is greater than 0. Fine. So if our number is greater than 0, we'll go again and we'll perform this step. Okay. So you can see here we are getting the remainder here by modulo function, and our sum is 0. Initially our sum is 0. So in first step, suppose my number is 153. So in this step, I'll get remainder as 3. So in first step, what I'll get? 0 plus 3 cube. Okay. So in second, in third, this step, I'll get 153 divided by 10, that is 15. Okay, so it will check here. 15 is greater than 0. Yes, it is greater than 0. So again, it will go. It will now the next step remainder will be 5. So initially my sum was 3 cube plus 5 cube. Okay, again it will come here. So 15 divided by 10, my answer will be 1. So 1 is greater than 0. Yes, it is greater than 0. So again, it will go 1 more 10. The answer is 1. So initially my sum was 3 cube plus 5 cube, now plus 1 cube. Now here 1 divided by 10, it is 0. Okay, so is num greater than 0? No. Fine, so it will go to false statement. So false. Now its sum equals to temp. Okay, so whatever sum you got, if it is equal to the number, okay, so the number we store in temp variable. So if it is equal to temp, then it is Armstrong. If not, okay, so it is not Armstrong. So I have left here something, that is from here the arrow will go to this step. Okay, so from here there is one arrow which will connect to this. Fine, so sorry for this, there are two mistakes in this that I have done. First is set sum equals to 0, here will be sum equals to 0, and second an arrow will go from here till this. Okay, so third question is, what do you mean by programming language? Explain about the evolution of programming language. Okay, so what is programming language? A programming language is a computer language that is used by programmers to communicate with computer. Okay, so now this is, see, whatever we are learning. Okay, so this is a programming language. So for evolution of programming language, we have 5 generation of programming language: first generation, second generation, third generation, fourth generation, and fifth generation. Okay, so first generation programming language, it is also called machine language. Okay, so what is machine language? Machine language is the set of instructions and data that computer understands. Okay, so this is the language which is machine dependent but human independent. It means it is closer to machine but it is not close to human being. So this type of language, example of this type of language is in the form of zeros and ones. Okay, going to second generation language. So this generation of language, it is also called assembly language. So assembly language is better than machine language, better in the sense of it can be understandable by human. Okay, but it is not very close to human. Okay, assembly language is human readable notation. Fine, for example, add. So this type of language, we call it mnemonics. Okay, so an assembly language programmer writes instruction using symbolic instruction codes that are meaningful abbreviation or called mnemonics. Okay, so add, sub, increase, decrease. So this symbolic form of language, so they are called assembly language. Okay, for an assembler is a program that translates assembly language into machine language. Okay, so we can use an assembler to translate our assembly language into machine language. Okay, so I have copied this diagram from somewhere, okay, from internet. This is not my own diagram. So you can see here, these are the machine languages. This is assembly language, and this is the example of high language that we are using today. Okay, so third generation language. So third generation language, it is also called procedural language. So our C programming, it falls under third generation language. It uses a series of English-like words which are closer to human language to write the instructions. Okay, so you might have experienced by writing C program. It is much more closer to human being. We understand what we are writing. High-level programming language makes complex programming simpler and easier to read, written, write, and maintain. Program written in high-level language must be translated into machine-level language by compiler or interpreter. Okay, so again, like assembler used to convert assembly language into machine language, similar way, this procedure, this third generation language, it must be translated into machine language by using compiler or interpreter. So example of these languages are Pascal, Fortran, Basic, COBOL, C, C++. Okay, so again, I have copied this diagram from some source, so I have mentioned the source here. So you can see, this is our high level language. Okay, so C++ code it is. So compiler is used to convert this into intermediate language, that is object code. Again, a linker is used to convert that object code into executable format in binary language. Fine. Next is fourth generation language. So a detailed explanation about this compilation process, I shall make another video for it. Okay. So fourth generation programming language. So the fourth generation programming language, it is also called non-procedural language, often abbreviated as 4GL, that enables user to access data in a database. Okay. So example of this type of language can be a query language or SQL. Okay. A very high level programming language is often referred to as goal-oriented programming language because it is usually limited to a very specific application. Fine. So for very specific applications, we use this fourth generation language. So example of this language is SQL or query language. Next is fifth generation language. So we can see this fifth generation language, it is very close to UNB. Okay. So example of this is like we are talking to machine. Okay. UN can talk to machine. For example, Siri. Okay. So you can give instruction to machine without any programming. Fine. So fifth generation programming allow people to interact with the computer without needing any specialized knowledge. People can talk to computer. For example, Prolog and Mercury. Okay, they are the example of fifth generation language. So coming to next question, we have fourth question. So what are unary operator? Why are they named so? So this question was asked in 2068 Chaitra. So this might be a 2 or 3 marks question. Okay. So what are unary operator? So according to question you have to write. Okay. If it is of 2 or 3 marks, so this is enough. If it is of 6 or 8 marks, so you need to give example of each of them. Fine. So according to the marks you need to write the answers. So various unary operator in C are increment operator. So it will increase the value of any variable by 1. Okay, decrement operator, it will decrease the value of decrease any variable value by 1. Okay, unary plus, which is plusing, which is the plus which is done for only one operand, and unary minus. Okay, so they are named so because unary operator requires a single operand to operate. Okay, so again, like detailed video of these operators, so we have uploaded in our tutorial. You can check that. Next is, write a program to check whether a teaser is triangular number or not. Fine. So this question has been asked in 2072 Chaitra. So this question is of 8 marks. Fine. So you should know what is triangular number. So triangular number are those numbers which are obtained by continued summation of natural number. For example, 1 is a triangular number. Okay. So now let's add 2 natural numbers, that is 1 plus 2. So it will be equal to 3. So 3 is a triangular number. Again, 1 plus 2 plus 3 is equal to 6. So 6 is a triangular number. Again, 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4. So it will equal to 10. So 10 is a natural number. Again, 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 plus 5. So 15 is a triangular number. So in this way, you go on adding, and whatever sum you will get, that is triangular number. So we have list of triangular numbers like 1, 3, 6, 10, 15. Okay, so these are the triangular number. Fine. So for this portion, I will show you this portion by executing my code. Fine. So this is my code for triangular number. I will just fix my. Okay. So I think I cannot move my screen. So it's okay. I have written this code in Word also. So I will explain from here only. Okay. So first of all, we have entered a number. Then we have set a value of sum to 0. Fine. So we enter a number. Okay. So for example, if I enter 6, so I'll read that in value 6. I will slice my value of I to 1. So here is a condition. So if sum is less than equal to num, Okay, so initially, okay, this one, this commented form I had written in my this DevC, but now I am not able to fix my screen, so just ignore that comment part. Okay, so in first case I equals to 1, so sum, so initially sum is 0, so 0 is less than equal to 6. Yes, it is less than equal to 6, so we'll come to the body. So sum will be equal to 0 plus I value is 1, so 1. Now we'll increase the value of I to 2. Okay, so if sum is equals to num, no, it is not equal, so sorry, if sum is equals to num, so in first case our num is, what is our num, enter the number 6. Okay, so 6 is not equal to sum, fine, so that is not triangular number, so it will not go to this portion. Again the cursor will go up, so now my value of sum is 1, so 1 is less than equals to num. Yes, it is equal, so it will go to the body part. So now the value of I is 2, so sum 1 plus value of I is 2, so 1 plus 2 equals to 3. Okay, so sum is 3, value of I increases to 3. Sum is equals to num, no, it is not equal, so it will not go to this part. So again it will go up like to while body, so sum, now the value of sum is 3. 3 is less than equal to num, yes. Now sum will be, value of I was 3, so 3 plus 3, it is equal to 6. The value of I becomes 4, so now sum is equal to num, yes, 6 is equal to 6, hence 6 is a triangular number. Okay, so in this way you can check any number whether it is triangular or not. Okay, so last question for today, so it is, write a program to read the number until 1 is encountered. Also count the number of even number and odd number entered by the user. Okay, so this program, it was asked in 2070 ASR. So in this program they have asked us, like, you should give the input. So if you give 2, so again they'll ask the input. So you give 3, again they'll ask the input. So suppose you give 5, in this way they'll ask you to give the input until you enter a 1. So the time you'll enter 1, they'll give you the number of even number, the number of odd number that you entered. Okay, so in odd number it will include 1 also. Fine, so this is our program. So I have taken a number, okay, variable, even, odd. So even I have initialized it to value 0, and odd I have initialized it to value 0. So this even and odd I have used as a counter. Fine, so while number is not equal to 1, okay, it means till the user doesn't enter 1. So it goes into the body, it will enter the number. Okay, so suppose if I enter number 2, okay, 2. So if number 2 is 0, so yes, 2 more 2 is 0. Okay, so it will be, the count of even will become 1. Fine, and it will again go to the loop. So again, it will go to the loop, again it will ask, enter a number. Okay, so now suppose if I enter 3, fine, so number 2 is 3 more 2 is 0, no, so it will go to else part, it will increase the value of odd by 1. Okay, so in this way I'll enter my numbers and it will increase the value of counters accordingly. Okay, so the moment I enter my number as 1, okay, so 1 more 2 is 0, no, so it will increase the odd part, odd counter by 1, and it will go to the while loop. So in this case now my num, which is 1, so 1 is not equal to 1, so it is not true, it is false, so it will come out of its body and it will print number of odd number is percentage %d, okay, number of even number is percentage %d, so it will give odd and even count. Fine, so here is the output. So enter number 3, enter number, so I entered 5, 4, again I entered 5, I entered 7, I entered 6, I entered 1. So finally my program has given me number of odd number is 4 and number of even number is 2. Okay, so you can see here, fine. Okay, so I think this was my last question. Okay, fine, so thank you very much for watching this tutorial video. So maybe next week I'll come again with previous year question discussion part 2. Fine, till then stay safe, thank you very much.